Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. Thank you for joining us today for this webinar. My name is Aparna Tyagi, and I work as Associate Fellow at the Energy and Resources Institute, New Delhi, which is a leading organization working in the field of energy, environment, and sustainable development over the last four decades. The National Forest Policy of 1988 and the subsequent circular on the joint forest management in 1990 created the space for community participation in management of forest resources, following which the joint forest governance by the state is achieved through joint forest management committees and other similar institutions such as the BMCs, EDCs, Gram Panchayats, etc. In order to understand the linkages and working of these institutions, we will be having a series of webinars. Biodiversity management committees have formed under the Biological Diversity Act of 2002 and are one of the most important institutions that prepare and update people's biodiversity registers and are also responsible for the equitable benefit sharing from the commercial use of the biological resource. With this context, in today's webinar, we will focus on understanding the linkages of these BMCs and other local institutions of the community participation, such as the JFMCs, EDCs, and Panchayati Raj institutions for biodiversity conservation and management in India from our eminent panelists. I'm happy to share today that today's discussion will be chaired by Dr. V.B. Mathur, Chairperson, National Biodiversity Authority. Sir has joined the Indian Forest Services and topped the 1983-85 IFS professional course at the IGNFA Dehradun. After serving for 33 years at the prestigious Wildlife Institute of India, Dr. Mathur was appointed by the Government of India as the 11th chairperson of the National Biodiversity Authority on 1st of September 2019. He has been actively contributing on research policy interface issues. Our panelists for the day are Dr. J.V. Sharma. Dr. Sharma is a 1983 batch retired IFS officer from Uttar Pradesh cadre who is presently working as Director, Land Resources Division, TERI. Dr. Yogesh Kokhale, Senior Fellow, TERI. Sri Alok Prem Nagar, who is Joint Secretary, Ministry of Panchayati Raj. Ms. Priya Tairi, Consultant, Ministry of Tribal Affairs. And Dr. Charan Singh, Scientist at FRI, Dehradun. Just a small announcement before we get started. I request everyone to have their attention on the screen. And if you have any questions during the presentations and discussions, please type them into the question and answer box in your GoToWebinar control panel and the name of the person the question is addressed to. I'll bring them up at the end of the session. Now, without further ado, I request Dr. J.V. Sharma to deliver the welcome address.
Thank you, Aparna. On behalf of the Energy and Resources Institute, TERI, I welcome Dr. Vinod Mathur, V.B. Mathur, Chairperson, Chairman, National Biodiversity Authority, my batchmate, my colleague, and Sri Alok Nagar, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Panchayati Raj, my colleague, Dr. Yogesh Gokhale, Dr. Charan Singh from the ICFRE representative, and Mr. Priya Tayade, representative of the Ministry of Tribal Affairs. Why we are here today? TERI has been assigned the responsibility to conduct a research on the institutions of the community participation, including joint forest management committees and eco-development committees, linkages with the Panchayati Raj institution, review of their working in various regions of the country, and identification of successful models and the shortcomings. And the objective we have been provided by the ICFRE to analyze the working of the institutional arrangement for community participation in the environment, forest, and wildlife sector in terms of the role and responsibility, functionality, sustainability, adequacy of benefits to the community, etc. Recognition of these institutions by other departments, ministries in the state as well as in the central government for the implementation of different their schemes, to see the self-sustenance of these institutions and its role in the empowerment of the community, to study the legal backing up of these institutions in state of Uttarakhand, states and territory, and the integration and coordination with the Panchayati Raj institution. Here I'd like to mention that in many of the document by many of the various central government ministries, they use the word legal backup. And here I advise everyone that kindly go through the administrative law. And what is administrative law? There is no legislation, no act like administrative act or administrative law. It is a compilation of the different rules, regulations, notifications by the government. Even the JFMCs, EDCs are with the notification of the government, still they have the legal backup. Of course, the legal backup, the committees having a legal originated from the law, of course, they have the more focus and more trust. But it is not be just fair to say that establishing an institution through a notification by the central government or the state government do not have the legal backup. They have the legal backup, and to suggest the ways to improve the functioning of these institutions. Review of the working of these institutions in various regions of the country and identification of the successful model. That is the main output of this research study. We have reviewed the literature and come out with the fact that there is a multiplicity of the community-based institutions for managing and conserving forest, wildlife, and biodiversity, such as JFMCs, eco-development committees, biodiversity management committees, water management committees, water user associations, watershed development committees, forest right committees, one panchayat community, one panchayat committee are there, community forest resource right committees are there, village forest committees under section 28 of the Indian Forest Act and village councils and largely in the scheduled area. There's so many multiple institutions, community-based institutions are functioning. In the Schedule 5 area, Gram Sabha-based governance is recognized under the PESA and the FRA 2006. Biodiversity management committees are at the panchayat level and under Biological Diversity Act 2003 in Schedule 6 area. Much of the forests are and natural resources are community-owned and they are conserving and managing since ages. So many institutions like JFMCs and EDCs are established with a notification. I mentioned that the community forest management committees and the biological diversity BMCs are established in the authority of legislation, such as PESA, FRA, and the Biological Diversity Act 2002. Another conflict is that these legislations are administered by the different ministries at the central government level. Ministries do not want to share their authority to the administrative ministry of the subject matter. I give you the example. FRA and FRA based committees are being managed by the Ministry of Tribal Affairs, the nodal agency. Whole forest is being controlled and managed by the under the purview of the Ministry of Environment Forest. So that there is a, of course, there is a mechanism in the Government of India that inter-ministerial committees, inter-ministerial coordination committees, etc., etc. But reality is that no ministry wants to share the authority and the domain with other ministries. So this is one of the major conflict that has to be removed at the first at the central government level, then state government level, then at the ground level. So today we are mandated to discuss how the biological BMCs could function efficiently with other institutions such as JFMCs, EDCs, and community forest management committees under the Gram Sabha. In Schedule 5 area, BMCs are at Gram Sabha level, and in area other than Schedule 5 and 6 under the Gram Panchayat level, there are overlapping mandate with the different community-based committees managed by different ministries and different laws. The objective of today's webinar is to synchronize BMCs with other community-based institutions for better conservation of the natural resources, forest, and the biodiversity. But what is happening at the ground level? Nodal agency, as far as FRA is concerned, in here, Ministry of Tribal Affairs, in states, either state tribal department or the social welfare department, and the forest department, that institution is watching and looking from the outside. So that until unless the whole stakeholders are not involved, then we will not be able to will not succeed in achieving our objective for the sustainable forest management, biodiversity conservation, and passing on the benefits to the grassroots level community based who is managing these resources. So of course it is very, very difficult task if we say that Gram Sabha Panchayati PMCs are should be at Gram Sabha level in the Schedule 5 area, because all committees, all natural resource management is functioning and working at the Gram Sabha level. So likewise, these kind of the synchronization is very, very key and important. And on these topics, different experts are here, so that we will take views of everyone, and with the permission of chair, today's webinar chair, Dr. V.B. Mathur, and he will conclude. And on the basis of this conclusion and the views expressed, we'll prepare the proceedings of the webinar and circulate it to them. And on the basis of that, what is the views comes out of the today's webinar, we will suggest to the ICFRE or the Government of India the kind of a linkages are needed and required for the better conservation of the forest as well as the biodiversity. With these words, I stop here. Thank you very much for the patient listening. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir. I now request Dr. V.B. Mathur to give the opening remarks.
Thank you very much. Dr. J.V. Sharma, my dear fellow panelists, ladies and gentlemen. It's indeed a pleasure for me to participate in this webinar, which is being jointly organized by TERI and ICFRE. I must begin by complimenting the organizers for this initiative, which I feel is very urgently required, and it is very, very timely. I would also say that this topic represents the heart and soul of the effective management of the Biological Diversity Act. And the primary responsibility of the National Biodiversity Authority is to ensure and promote effective implementation of the BD Act. And therefore, my presence today and my participation is basically a reflection that I consider this topic very important. And therefore, when Dr. Sharma requested a few weeks back that we need to organize that, and I said, yes, this is a very, very important area where, as he was just mentioning, there is definitely a multiplicity of agencies, but I'm very sure that we are, or we should be able to sort them out. So therefore, linkages are important. And fortunately, we are talking of multiple linkages, and we need to ensure that coherence is achieved. Now, I take you back to the Convention on Biological Diversity, which is the most important multilateral environmental agreement in the context of overall governance of the Biological Diversity Act. Now, CBD, I must say, is a universal convention. There are only four countries or states in the world which are not currently the members of the CBD. And these are Andorra, South Sudan, of course, the big United States of America, and the tiny holy city of Vatican. So other than these four countries, all countries in the world are part of the CBD, which basically has three important objectives. It is important to reiterate that. I'm very sure in this audience, we have people who know about it, but there could be a few who would like to know what the CBD tenets are. So obviously it is conservation of biological diversity, it is sustainable use of its components, and most importantly, the fair and equitable sharing of benefits. And it is here that we need this coherence and convergence over there. And therefore, India, when it became a party to the CBD, we of course took 10 long years to enact our own legislation. So in 1992 we signed the CBD, and it took us 2002 to enact our BD Act, and of course the rules in 2004. Now interestingly, the context is very important. Our biodiversity governance is a three-tier mechanism. At the top or at the apex level, it is the National Biodiversity Authority, where I sit and where I work in Chennai at the national level. But then there are 28 state biodiversity boards in each of our state. And only very recently, we have empowered our union territories. So union territories also now have what we call as union territories biodiversity councils. So that is the middle layer of our governance. But the most important one is what we are discussing today, the biodiversity management committee at the local level of implementation. And that is where the context becomes important. I would also say, and I will be very candid, that if you look at the entire range of environmental legislations in the country, I would feel that the Biological Diversity Act is the least understood. Whereas it talks about management of biodiversity, protection of traditional knowledge, creation of biodiversity heritage sites. But despite all these years of its existence, it is the least understood one. And when I say least understood, I am talking of government machinery, I am talking of businesses, I am talking of civil society, and everyone who is connected with it, there is, I would say, a lack of understanding. And there are many reasons for it. I don't want to point out that this is because of this or that. Maybe the ministry and the NBA and myself are also part of this poor responsibility which I'm talking to. And that was the reason one year back, we started a webinar series on the BD Act. Every month, we got an eminent speaker to talk about some facets of the BD Act so that people could understand, our own state biodiversity boards could understand. And I must say with pleasure that this has had a remarkable effect, so to say, that people's ignorance is a shade better, although we have a long way to go. I want to draw your attention to one important thing which happened in the process. In July 2016, a gentleman, or we can call him a Pune-based activist, Chandrabhal Singh, he approached the NJT and he said that the effective implementation of the BD Act is not taking place. And perhaps he was right. Because of the 270,000 local bodies across the country, in July 2016, only 9,700 of them had BMCs, a compliance of merely 3.48%, less than 4%, I would say, had the BMC constituted. And if you talk in terms of PBRs, which is their main function, of the 9,700 BMCs, only about 1,300 had the PBRs. So the compliance level was very, very poor. So now, while on one hand we say that this is a very important piece of legislation, but look at our track record that we were not able to set up all these committees and prepare these registers in the 14 years of its existence. And therefore, the NJT was very right. It passed on several orders on the Ministry of Environment and Forests, on the NBA. And it was in August 2018 first that the NJT directed compliance of the constitution of BMCs and preparation of the PBRs. But the landmark judgment came in August 2019. And incidentally, this was just a month earlier when I joined NBA. I joined NBA on 1st of September, and on 8th of August, the NJT gave a judgment saying or directing 100% compliance of the constitution of BMCs and preparation of PBRs by 31st January 2020. Not only this, there was one more piece in that, that in case of default, the states will be fined 10 lakh rupees per month. And each month till the BMC formation is complete and the PBRs are made. So obviously, the work for me was cut out. All my colleagues and all my efforts were to ensure the compliance. On the lighter side, I must say that several of my colleagues said that we should go back to NJT and contest this order. But knowing the working of the judiciary and admitting the fact that the act came into being in 2002 and we have not done anything, it would be futile to go to the NJT at that point. So we said that let's start on the process of constituting them. And fortunately, I would say now that the office of the chief secretaries in the country is very, very important one. And what I did every month was to write a DO letter to the chief secretary saying that this is the judgment, this is the performance of your state, and please see that this prostitution takes place. And it had a remarkable effect. This is again very, very interesting. In March 2021, that is this month I am now talking, the rate of compliance stands at 98% for the BMCs. From 4%, we have moved to 98% in the context of BMCs and about 88% for the PBRs. So the NJT orders have been a great help. But at the same time, I must admit that there is an issue with respect to quality of PBRs. I cannot say, or nobody would say, that the PBRs are of a quality or of a high quality. The ministry is looking into it. We have set up committees. We have prepared a framework for quality evaluation. And both at the central government level and at the state level, efforts are currently on. All states have also constituted a state level quality monitoring committees over there. Now, coming back to this theme of this webinar, the linkages between BMCs and the Panchayati Raj institutions, the Section 41 of the BD Act very clearly says that every local body shall constitute a biodiversity management committee, and for the purpose of promoting conservation, sustainable use, documentation of biological diversity, conservation of land races, folk varieties, cultivars, domestic stocks, everything which is connected to biological diversity is the responsibility of that. And one of the most important functions of the BMC is to prepare the People's Biodiversity Register. I'm sure everybody recalls and remembers Professor Madhav Gadgil. When he started working on it many, many years ago, he said that we need to record people's knowledge, their perception, the status, the use, the history, the ongoing changes, and all that is concerned with the biological diversity levels at the local localities. Now, I want to draw your attention to Section 41 again, which says every local body shall constitute a BMC within its area. And this brings us to the 73rd and the 74th Amendment of the Constitution that has added two new parts. Part 9, of course, my colleague Alok is there from the Ministry of Panchayati Raj, but I must say the panchayats have been added under the 73rd Amendments, and Part 9A has added the municipality via the 74th Amendment. The point I'm making is that the Panchayati Raj institutions are fully constitutional in character. These amendments have built democratic governance process at the grassroots level. And now comes the BD Act. We need to look both the things together. It is not that they are in conflict with each other. They are part of the same constitution. The BD Rules 22/2 says that BMC shall consist of a chairperson, not more than 6 persons nominated by the local body. So there is a very strong organic link that we are talking. It is not that we are talking of two different things. And then it says 1/3 should be women and not less than 18% should be scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. That is where my colleague from Mota comes into play, that we need to ensure that the constitution is proper, the representation is proper, and the process of BMC formation takes place. So now the question comes, the role of Ministry of Panchayati Raj, that through its network of local bodies, and I'm sure Alok is going to explain more of that, but they have a very significant role in planning, management, and monitoring of natural resources. And very interesting learnings I have made in the last 18 months or so, which is the Gram Panchayat Development Plan, what we call as the GPDP. This is the development plan of the Gram Panchayat, which is prepared through a participatory process. It involves all stakeholders and it reflects the needs and priorities along with available resources. So this GPDP is the mechanism which binds all of us together, whether we are in environment and forest or whether we are in tribal affairs. But this particular document, and I'm very sure Alok is going to explain to us that how this can form a kind of a fulcrum where we can bring convergence in our activity. So what exactly do we want? We want mainstreaming to take place. We want that economic benefits of conservation and management are harnessed through the Gram Panchayat, through the mission and through the activities of the Gram Panchayat Development Plan. And in the same breath, I will say that access and benefit sharing, which is the heart and soul of the BD Act, can only be realized if we make our GPDP and our BMCs talk to each other. And therefore, there are guidelines for GPDP, which have again been revised in October 2018, and they very strongly emphasize inclusion of biodiversity conservation and related activities which are there. And therefore, as NBA, we are committed to provide the technical support, whatever is required. And very interestingly, I want to mention the last thing, which of course has resulted in this panel today. All of us are networked, and I would say that with Alok coming into MOPR and me coming into the Ministry of Environment and Forest and Dr. J.V. Sharma in Terry, we work together to say that how do we improve and make best use of our communication and networking skills. And that is where comes the role of the Ministry of Panchayati Raj. And I am very grateful to Mr. Alok, who suggested that we should open up a dialogue, and we have funds coming under the 15th Finance Commission. Now, this 15th Finance Commission, as you understand, provides funds to all local bodies, and the local bodies spend in all their matters from sanitation to water harvesting to whatever things they do. But there was no mention of the BMC and of the People's Biodiversity Register. And that is what is important, a game changer, if I can say so, that this has now been added in that OM, which has been issued by the MOPR, that the funds which have been received by the local bodies, they can also be spent for the purpose of strengthening of BMCs and of making of PBR. So this is already happening. I do not have figures at this point that how many local bodies and how many BMCs have been able to unlock these funds. But at least at the policy level, at the highest level of governance, the thought processes are there. It is up to us that we make the best use of that. So this is something what I would say, that the stage is well set in terms of policy dialogue, in terms of policy prescriptions. It is now for us to work together and to ensure. And therefore, this work which Terry and ICFRE are doing are very, very important. And I will now wait for my other colleagues to come in. And towards the end, we can work out a roadmap that with this theoretical construct in place, how do we make this a practical reality? And how do we ensure convergence taking place in all spheres of our activity? So thank you once again, and I will hand it back to the organizers. I think Terry is looking into that. So please, and we will have other speakers talking about this issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving your valuable insights on today's topic of discussion. I now request Dr. Yogesh Gokhale, Senior Fellow TERI, to give the presentation on linkages of biodiversity management committees with institutions of community-based natural resources management. So,
yeah. Thank you. I am privileged to be here as one of the panelists among the distinguished senior officers like my director, Dr. Sharma, Dr. B.B. Mathur, Mr. Alok Prem Nagar Saab, and also Shri Charan Singh Ji and the colleague Ms. Priya Tayade. Where I come with a background, though I am not an administrative service officer, but I come with a background as a researcher who did his postdoc on doing methodology of People's Biodiversity Register with Professor Gadgil's group almost 18 years back, and also followed the development of Biological Diversity Act when it was in the form of bill. So it's a real pleasure to continue with the association of with the subject and also with the realities and to live with the realities of those things. Now, I need not say much more about importance of biodiversity because more than 30 crores of the Indian population who are forest dwellers are primarily dependent on their forest for their livelihoods. And they are also contributing as one of the drivers of forest degradation, since they are extracting fuel wood, they are grazing their cattle, they are unsustainably harvesting manure forest produce. Without no bad intentions, but because they do not have sustainable harvesting management practices to follow. Various state biodiversity boards across India have identified over 300 species of plants and animals as endangered. And today, the forest and wildlife are concurrent subjects where states play important role for implementation as per the existing policy and regulatory regimes as per the constitutional provisions. As Dr. Mathur referred to the 73rd and 74th amendments of the constitution, I would also like to pay attention to some of the other provisions, constitutional provisions, such as Article 48A, which talks about endeavor to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard the forest and wildlife of the country. Article 40, which describes the conceptual aspects of Panchayati Raj and its workings and shortcomings, and discuss features of the 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act of 1992. Article 51AG, to regarding duty of every citizen of India to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, and wildlife, and to have compassion for living creature. And Article 21, the principle of sustainable development, which has been linked to right to life, and which is a kind of fundamental right. So, as was discussed, the 73rd Amendment has really changed the perspective of the participatory management of natural resources and also involvement of the Gram Sabha per se in the overall functioning of the system. National Forest Policy, which basically identified ecological security of nation as the prime objective, people's involvement in the management, conservation, and protection of forest, sustenance needs, and livelihood of the people living in and around forest have the first charge on the forest, and economic derivatives and other objectives are subordinate to prime objective. So this is a larger principle that National Forest Policy provided in 1988. And then subsequently, in consonance with the 1988 Forest Policy, we have an elaborate policy, legal, and institutional framework in which forest and biodiversity government in India is getting operated. There are three important policies of like NFP 1988, National Environment Policy 2006, Agroforestry Policy 2014. Then there are important ministries such as Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Tribal Affairs, Panchayati Raj, Rural Development at the central level. Then the state forest departments, biodiversity boards, and related other Department of Panchayati Raj, Department of Tribal Affairs, at the state level, then the local institutions such as biodiversity management committees, joint forest management committees, at the Gram Sabha level, at the local level, Gram Panchayat level, and then there are also Gram Sabhas and other aspect that is of judicial activism, which is part of this institutional framework and cannot be ignored. Along with these, these ministries are working on the field with the help of the regulatory mechanisms, the legislations, namely Indian Forest Act, Wildlife Protection Act, Biodiversity Act, Forest Right Act, Forest Conservation Act, EPA, and the subsequent rules framed to implement these legislations. I might have missed one or two acts, but that can be then discussed later if required. With this, as was discussed, there are concerns of governance of forest and biodiversity because of number of acts and number of provisions. Various acts have been formed at various point of time in history. Subsequent to that, there have been several amendments, but there have been issues with respect to what has been amended and what has been amended and how it has reflected on the ground. So there have been overlapping functions and responsibilities of institutions of governance. There are observed conflicts and contradictions of Gram Sabha and Gram Panchayat based governance. There is a need of governance model for sustainable forest management and enhanced livelihood through convergence of existing provisions and with respect to ease of implementation. This ease of implementation is extremely important while we discuss during this webinar. Then there is a need to consider national and state policies and regulatory paradigm, judiciary orders, and identification of lacuna from field for improved governance for sustainable natural resource management. So as Dr. Sharma had mentioned, TERI is conducting a project from ICFRE to analyze the working of institutional arrangements for community participation, recognition of these institutions by other departments, ministries in state and center in implementation of their schemes, to see the self-sustenance of these institutions and its role in empowerment of the community, to study the legal backing of these institutions in states as well as union territories, to suggest ways to improve the functioning of these institutions and review of working of these institutions in various regions of the country and how the and what kind of successful models have been formed. So there are a number of committees which are functional at various so-called local levels. So like, for example, since the decade of 1990, we have joint forest management committees which have been functioning at village level or even at the hamlet level within a village. There is nothing specified in the orders 1990 or even the subsequent orders about which level the JFMC should be formed. It was not needed either. Then we have Forest Right Committee as well as Community Forest Resource Management Committees, which are getting formed right now, but which are supposed to function at the Gram Sabha level. Then Eco Development Committee is largely restricted to the around protected areas, and they are replacement to Joint Forest Management Committees around protected areas, and they are also formed at village or hamlet level. Then, of course, Biodiversity Management Committee. Then we have Watershed Management Committees. There are in number of states now called Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sichai Yojana, but earlier IWMP programs have been conducted, and the Gram Panchayat level committees are formed for the implementation of watershed programs. Then around wildlife area, there are conservation reserve management committees, which are formed under the Wildlife Protection Act, which are village level. Then there are community reserve management committees, the wildlife, which are again under Wildlife Protection Act and formed at village level. Then one panchayat, which are specifically restricted to Uttarakhand, and one panchayats are often conglomeration of number of villages which are linked to a single one panchayat, coming under one panchayat. Then in schedule 5-6 area, there are village councils. Yeah, like in case of Lushail's district village district act 1953 in Mizoram, or there are village forest committee, village forest committees under Indian Forest Act section 28, which are also at the level of village. Then there are PESA committee, which are supposed to be functioned at Gram Sabha level, formed under PESA. Of course, there was a mention of GPDP, Gram Panchayat Development Plan. So there is at Panchayat level, the process of for preparing GPDP is also happening through a committee. So there are a number of committees which are happening, which are functioning at various levels, so-called local. So within local also, we have a number of scales that we realize. So if we see the applicability and availability of variety of these committees, then we would realize that most of these committees are applicable and or available in Schedule 5, Schedule 6, as well as in non-scheduled areas. Except for there are a few exceptions, like one panchayats are in Uttarakhand, village councils are largely in northeast, some of the states of northeast like Nagaland, Mizoram, parts of Assam, the parts of Tripura, and so on. Then village forest committees are there in selected states where section 28 of Indian Forest Act has been enacted. So like Maharashtra, then also Kerala, they have used these provisions. And also PESA committees are there where for the scheduled areas. So, but more or less, many committees, one would see that those are functioning or are ideally applicable for all parts of the country. So there is bound to have a multiplicity of institutions and multiplicity of regulatory regime. So these multiplicity of institutions and regulatory mechanisms and mandates, how do they come out? How they reflect? So there is as National Forest Policy provides a mandate of ecological security, recognition of rights and concessions of bona fide forest dwellers, which could not be settled during consolidation of forest and formation of state, and involvement of local people in sustainable forest management. So once there is this mandate, is this hierarchical, topmost hierarchical mandate is identified, then to follow up on that, there are multiple institutions at the local level, like joint forest management committees, eco-development committees, BMCs, CFRMCs. There are Gram Sabha level forest governance through JFMCs in Maharashtra and Kerala. At the same time, in many states at that level, one would find the committees of externally aided projects, say, for example, committee of JICA or for which the projects are going on. So there are such kinds of local level multiplicity of institutions one would realize. Then there is a multiplicity of regulatory mechanism where Biodiversity Act largely operating at Gram Panchayat level through BMCs, Forest Act, PESA, Indian Forest Act, Wildlife Act, through these various committees. And what happens, there are certain functional requirements of all these community-based institutions. Like all these committees would need office bearers. And it's a general observation that more or less same set of people are part of this committee for any given village, mainly due to several limitations at local level. Many people may not have exposure to banking system. So those who are aware about banking system, they are being given those responsibilities in various committees. Those who are politically ambitious, so they share chairmanship, secretaryship with each other, and they exchange the committees. So the more or less office bearers remain, keep circulating for the same village, but across the committees. Documentation. Most of these committees need to develop documentation in form of micro plans, people's biodiversity registers, or same any other geographical area shared by entire village or habitation. Now there are financial management which are necessary for these committees. Maintain bank accounts, transparency in accounting and expenditure. So these systems are there across these committees, and these committees also report to different departments. So there is a certain kind of formalities which are to be followed and continued under these committee systems. Just a second, just bring it up, keep it up. But then coming to our present topic of Biological Diversity Act and the CBD, Dr. Mathur talked about there are only four nations which are not party to the Convention on Biological Diversity, which India signed on 1992. So basically the three objectives of conservation of biodiversity, sustainable use, and fair and equitable sharing of benefits arising out of the utilization of biological resources. So India is one of those early countries who acted upon the message of CBD and enacted Biological Diversity Act in 2002, which demonstrate India's commitment to these three principles of CBD. And for us, it is the only legislation which deals with access and benefit sharing from the commercial utilization of biological resources and safeguarding of traditional ecological knowledge for India. I think no other institutional mechanism in the country looks after ABS and safeguarding of TEK associated with the biological resources. So it's a very, very critical legislation and the institutional mechanism. So what does mean by access and benefit sharing? So ABS refers to the way in which genetic resources which can be accessed and how the benefits that result from their use are shared between the people or countries using the resources and the people or countries that provide them. So National Biodiversity Authority is the topmost institution to regulate all activities related to ABS. The BMCs need to be strengthened in the forest fringe to prevent over-exploitation of NTFPs and to facilitate ABS as per the provisions of BD Act. There are two very interesting features of this particular act, and those have been talked about quite a bit during the discussions on of the biodiversity bill at few decades back. One is the prior informed consent, and another is mutually agreed term. So the prior informed consent, where the NBA and SBBs are supposed to consult BMCs while providing access of the biological resources for commercial utilization. So it's a kind of mandatory requirement for National Biodiversity Authority to consult the biodiversity management committees and to develop mutually agreed terms, that is the terms and conditions that the user and the provider of the biological resources arrive at after negotiations. So that's why for sustainable use and equitable benefit sharing, there is no way we can neglect any form of BMC or any intervention by National Biodiversity Authority or State Biodiversity. So as was mentioned, these are the operational norms where NBA at the national level, State Biodiversity Board at the state level, BMC at the ZP and Jilla Parishad, and further at Panchayat and Municipality level. These are the operational norms in which the systems are functioning. As one would know that so far there is only one very good example, that is said by Tripura regarding access and benefit sharing, and they have also demonstrated collaborations with joint forest management system. I think I would request after my presentations sometime during the discussion, Dr. Mathur may explain us the pros and cons of Tripura model of ABS. But as an information, I would like to say that Tripura is one of the important examples. They have said that 2% of ABS cess is being shared with local communities and as part of the operationalization of biodiversity management committee and ABS mechanism. Now, what I have tried to do is that I have tried to look at some of the parameters which are important in the functioning of biodiversity management committee in terms of what has been mentioned in the act, rules, the subsequent guidelines which were published by NBA in 2013, and also going through various state rules the way they have implemented BMCs and tried to understand where are the commonalities, where are the differences, and how those could be then thought about, discussed in the context of convergence of the biodiversity management committee. So as per section 41 of BDM, every local body shall constitute a biodiversity management committee within its area for the purpose of promoting conservation, sustainable use and documentation of biological diversity, including preservation of habitats, conservation of land races, folk varieties, cultivars and so on. The National Biodiversity Authority and SBB shall consult BMC, and BMC may levy charges by way of collection of fees from any person for accessing or collecting any biological resource for commercial purposes. Now, there are important functional role of biodiversity management committees in terms of recording and updating of biodiversity related knowledge pertaining to management issues through People's Biodiversity Register, community regulation of access to local biodiversity resources leading to sustainable harvests, promoting knowledge-based sustainable management of agriculture, livestock, fish, forests, public health, so as to enhance the quality of life of community members, opportunity to generate funds through imposition of collection fees, conserving valued resources such as biodiversity heritage sites, or rather identification of biodiversity heritage sites, value addition to biological resources such as minor forest produce, recording of biodiversity related knowledge coupled to opportunities to generate funds through imposition of collection fees for access to local knowledge. So now when we see that how the formation of BMC has taken place, that as per the BDA rules and guidelines, BMCs are to be constituted at local body level and for Schedule 6 areas at the level of local institution recognized by autonomous district councils. When we see that for Assam and Tripura and Arunachal Pradesh, BMCs, where Assam and Tripura are part of Schedule 6 areas, the BMCs are formed at Gram Panchayat level, whereas for Nagaland, Meghalaya and Mizoram, they are formed at the local institutional recognized by autonomous district council. For non-scheduled areas, but of course Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra are categorized as Schedule 5 states, that the BMCs are formed at Gram Sabha level, but for other rest of the country, they are not formed at the Gram Sabha level. Well, Kerala is might be a different story. Then coming to the number of members and composition. So there are maximum 7 members proposed, 33% reservation for women and 18% reserved for SCs and STs as proposed by BD Act. And rules, whereas guidelines do not fix number and provide opportunity for State Biodiversity Board to suggest members along with choice of local body to draw from other committees. So here there is a kind of, in many states when we interact with local people, then there is a kind of confusion, how many number of should be there in the Biodiversity Management Committee. In Mizoram, Meghalaya, Tripura, Assam, they do not have any reservation for women. So they are probably may not, they are not gender sensitive, and SC or ST or any other social class either. Telangana, Odisha, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Andhra, they have a reserve membership to SC, ST in proportion to the population of such population in their district. Then again, with respect to tenure of Biodiversity Management Committee, BD rules propose 3 years. Guidelines propose 5 years or co-terminus with local body. So but for Assam, which has 5-year tenure, rest all states have 3-year tenure for BMC, as is mentioned in their rules. Then coming to the relationship with other institutions. Now BDA rules, BD Act and rules do not mention about relationship of BMCs with any other local institution, whereas guidelines mention integration of BMCs to other village level committees related to natural resource management. Interestingly, Mizoram, Tripura, Arunachal Pradesh, Sikkim, J&K, Rajasthan, MP, Odisha, Chhattisgarh, rules have provision of relationship with other relevant committees such as GFMCs, EDCs through cross membership, participation in meetings and so on. So there is, these states have thought about such kind of relationship. Then another issue is BMCs as executing agency, where Biodiversity Act anticipated BMCs to go beyond documentation for promotion of conservation and sustainable use. The rules mainly restrict to documentation of PBRs, and guidelines emphasize on having action plan based on PBR for conservation and sustainable use. And in many states, PBRs or the actions of BMCs have been just reduced as a body which documents and keeps quiet and does no execution work like JFMCs. And that is the reality in most of the places. Another issue which we have been talking about for long, but it has been neglected or not properly communicated, that is with respect to the jurisdiction. The restricting jurisdiction of BMC to panchayat boundary, that is revenue boundary, is restricting the scope of work and whole purpose of Biological Diversity Act. Since majority of the biodiversity resources and associated traditional knowledge are found beyond revenue boundaries of gram panchayat, the traditional knowledge and resources which would found within the boundaries of revenue boundaries would be largely related to the agriculture, livestock, and to some extent fisheries, but certainly not with respect to the forest and other ecosystems. Hence, customary boundaries as defined by Gram Sabha become important to fulfill the objectives of conserving and safeguarding biodiversity and associated traditional knowledge. If we see the status of the Biodiversity Management Committee, Dr. Mathur very nicely explained that since the orders of National Green Tribunal, how there has been exponential growth in terms of compliance of formation of BMCs and biodiversity registers, but he rightly pointed out the quality of the PBRs. But nevertheless, there is in any work we always talk about baseline, and now this is the baseline that has formed, and now it's our responsibility to update these biodiversity registers to in whatever form and which would be agreed at the national and state and the local level for our own purpose. But interestingly, we must not forget that there are over 118,000 JFMCs, which is another kind of resource which is available, along with 270,000 BMCs formed across India. At the same time, I tried very hard to understand how many Gram Sabhas would be there which are entitled to have the PESA committee under the PESA Act. Unfortunately, it would take a little time and make some exercise to understand that, and it's not difficult to arrive at a number, but interestingly, no one has tried to arrive at that number. So that many number of Gram Sabhas would need the immediate help of these PBRs to work on the natural resource management. Same is true for that many number of forest rights, the FRA committees, the CFRMCs. They would be needed the information of their biological resources for management of the CFRR areas. These are the potential users of biodiversity registers which are actually waiting to have a better documentation and quality material for use in the field. But what we need a kind of policy and regulatory basis and frameworks to understand historical association with the topic and resource management, because it's not needed that all of a sudden a new committee should start functioning. But if a very good JFM committee is in place, then it's important to build upon the historical work of that JFM committee in form of the new structure which is important at the local level. The existing operational mechanism for decision making and finance could be then revamped based on those issues, because there is immediate impact on livelihood that is linked with the functioning of such local committees, and ultimately the sustainability of natural resource is also dependent on functioning of the local committees which are available over there. So in the end, as I would reiterate, that there is a need to form BMCs at Gram Sabha level in Schedule 5 areas and even in non-scheduled areas, because the Gram Sabha would give you the access to the customary boundaries and not restrict oneself at the revenue boundaries at the panchayat level. There is a need of synchronization of various committees with BMC that is required. It needs to be worked out by respective ministries, departments, and communicated to the local bodies. I think I stop here and pass it on to Aparna, my colleague, to take the proceedings further. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your detailed presentation on BMCs. I now request Sri Alok Prem Nagar, sir, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Panchayati Raj, to share his views on today's topic, sir.
Thank you very much, Aparna. Respected panelists, it's a privilege to be here amongst you. So the chairman at the very beginning has sounded you about the importance of the GPDP, what is it that we do and how it seeks to bring about convergence. So just to give you a little more detail on that, it all flows from the Article 243G of the Constitution, which is a part of the 73rd Amendment. And so the panchayat really is the body that is responsible for all its planning that is being conducted, whether it within its geographical boundaries. There are also, referring to Mr. Gokhale's presentation, that out of the 2.5 lakh gram panchayats in the country, we have the boundaries only in respect of about 2,10,000. So the rest of the panchayats, for instance, in a state like mine in Himachal Pradesh, they still do not have delineated boundaries of gram panchayats. That's because there are forest areas and which have got rights of the communities from either side. So the gram panchayat is the main body, and the 29 subjects which are on the 11th schedule, the planning in respect of all those subjects is the Gram Panchayat's mandate, really. So it's not a matter of the departments agreeing to cede territory. It is something that is mandated. And if you've not done it now, then you've been largely in default. So that is the sense that has already been conveyed in the earlier speakers' presentations. So what we do to enable the panchayats to carry out their planning function, which flows from the constitution. So we carry out a campaign every year. It's called the People's Plan Campaign, Sabki Yojana Sabka Vikas. And we start the preparatory work sometimes in the month of July, where we start issuing letters. The 29 subjects are mapped onto 18 departments and ministries. And we reach out to the central government offices, the secretaries' offices, to ask them to tell us the GP-wise resource envelopes. To be able to plan, you must first know what is the quantum of resources that you have at your disposal. And then having got those resources with yourself, that is when you go and plan for them. So we've had limited success. The only resources we are able to provide the panchayats with ahead of their campaign is the Finance Commission resources. So currently they have both the 14th and 15th Finance Commission resources with them. RD Ministry and us, we work in close association. So we also have the estimated resource envelope under the MNREGA scheme. And believe me, there are no other resource envelopes that we have access to. We get apologies from various ministries. They tell us that we do not have GP-wise. So we reach out to the states. We tell them that against the central allocations, if you've been able to break it into disaggregated GP envelopes, or if you've not been able to break it into, if you can just give us the average of the previous few years, then that will be good because that is an indicative figure. And we get it from very few really. So these are the only two main resource envelopes that we have. To give you a sense of the kind of money that is involved, so in a Gram Panchayat, the funds that flow as a part of devolution are of the order of rupees 500 per person per year. So if you have a small Gram Panchayat, as in the case of Punjab, they have 500 strong, 600 strong Panchayat. So if you are a Panchayat of 1000 people, then you get 5 lakh rupees in a year. If you are a Gram Panchayat in West Bengal or Kerala, and you are 50,000 strong, 60,000 strong, you get a whopping amount coming into your banks as the Finance Commission devolution. It's important to understand this because even if we ask a panchayat to get invested in the preparation of a people's biodiversity register, then they have choices to make, and it's a very hard choice if you have an annual envelope only of 5 lakh rupees. So, but that is beside the point. So in People's Plan campaign, we also organize facilitators. So these are typically the community resource person under the state livelihood mission projects. These people are assigned this job that you have to reach out to the ground level staff. In the case of the forest department, it would be the forest guard or the agriculture extension officer, horticulture extension officer, pharmacist. You got to reach out to all these 18 department people and get them to attend the Gram Sabha meeting. Whenever that is scheduled, the scheduler is also there as a part of our portal. And talking of forests, out of the 2,50,673 panchayats for which Gram Panchayat development plans have been uploaded, only 20,700 frontline workers from the forest departments attended those Gram Sabha meetings. So that is less than 10%. And even in this number, there are highs and lows. So Jharkhand, which is a forest-rich state, so out of the 1143 Gram Sabhas that were held, in only 24 of them was there representation of the forest department. And of course, the highs are not too high, but in Nagaland, 572, we had 214 Gram Sabhas that were attended. Of course, they don't have a lot of Gram Sabhas. They are Schedule 6. So out of the Gram Sabhas, there was nearly 50% attendance. So that is the kind of band in which we are working, which is nothing to write home about, really, because we are not being able to achieve our objective. The only people who land up there would be the women and child development person, the Anganwadi person, the A&M. These people are found in big numbers, but forest department really is conspicuous by their absence. I have been a part of the forestry establishment, and I remember that at the start of every fire season, I would try and get my people to go out there and attend the Gram Sabha meetings so that they'd have greater participation of the people in the control of those fires. I'd made it a point of doing it. They had it on the 7th or 10th of April every year. So, but aside from that, I never even heard of a campaign like this People's Plan campaign. And they've been running it for 3 years now. So forest department is typically oblivious. The point was made in Dr. Gokhale's presentation also, when he said that you have all these committees and, with their overlapping roles, and there is not sufficient buy-in from these people because nobody's asked them to really. Yeah, so the point he made was in the context of externally aided projects. Before I came here, I was involved in writing a project proposal for JICA, Ecosystem Management Livelihood Improvement Project in Himachal Pradesh. I wanted to execute it using panchayats, being in the forest department, being a CCF and all that. And JICA wouldn't let me do that. They said, no, we have JFM committees implementing it everywhere. And if you bring it to the panchayats, you would be politicizing the process. So I would imagine that in such a scenario, because all these projects have to come through the Ministry of Environment and Forest, and so if the ministry could tell them that don't look for separate organs of implementation, don't do that, please, you're not supposed to. And because if you don't put your foot down there, then of course people don't feel the need. And these people out there, the forest people, I've seen them, work with them, they mean well. It is not like they are in deviant lot who are out to, you know, disobey all manner of instructions. It's a matter of who you interact with. So there are these faces. He also said in his presentation that in a lot of these committees, there are these same people who are occurring, because the village is the same thing. So looking at the data that I was talking about, the presence of the departments is low, especially in the context of forest, because forest is the customary custodians of the biodiversity which is found in our forest. And if these people were somehow not sensitive to this, then we wouldn't have a lot to hope for. So one needs to find ways of morphing all these multiplicity of committees into the instruments, into something like the BMC or the Forest Rights Committee as applicable. And their roles have to be adequately defined. I'm also not sure, sir, if the BMC is capable of doing developmental activities. Because if one were to just look at the Act, one saw that it is their job, of course, preparation of the People's Biodiversity Register is their job, and they have a regulatory function. And the Forest Rights Committee has, of course, the next speaker is going to talk about that. They have an advisory role. So the department is interacting on a day-to-day basis with people who do jobs, who carry out stuff, who carry out plantations and soil conservation measures and all. Who's going to do it, actually, if all these people are in the advisory capacity? So it would be good if this thing can be clarified. We've missed PESA in a lot of these discussions. So that is also a very important act. In fact, that is the precursor and to the Forest Rights Act that came. So it's been around for many years now. And so far, there are only six states. There is Andhra, Himachal, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, Telangana, and Gujarat who've notified their state PESA rules, which is something that is mandatory. There was talk earlier on of, you know, Dr. Sharma said that some state has notified rules under the Tribal Act, and are they even supposed to do it? So in PESA, they're all supposed to do it, sir. And very few have done that. So one would expect forest-rich states like Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, MP, and Odisha would run and do something about it. They haven't. So they do have some sort of systems. Like in Chhattisgarh, they have this cooperative societies or committees that are there. And the cooperative committees, there are almost 1,000 of them. So they have a similar model. People collect their produce and they bring it all together. So they have large volumes and they have greater, you know, bargaining clout as a result of that. But it is not the same as being owners of the produce. So they have a lot of ground to cover. And Chhattisgarh, I'm told, have conducted a workshop as late as the 4th of February with the other states and the other stakeholders for their PESA rules. So things are a little slow, and the GPs need to appreciate the role of People's Biodiversity Registers. I've already made that point, sir, when I said that they don't have a lot of money going around. And typically, their priorities would be roads and, you know, these contractor-driven activities, Khadanja or some such thing that everybody is happy to implement. So if you want them to be invested in a register that in the foreseeable future would bring them rich dividends, you really need to, you know, give them something to really raise an alarm about. We've had this talk earlier when I'd said that if we could, you're already doing that, sir. At that time, it had transpired that you've already located these panchayats all over the country. which would be like a demo for all other panchayats to see the benefits of having a good PBR and how it would lead to regular accruals for the gram panchayat. So that would be very good. And once we have such a directory or such demonstrated examples of states where they've done good, of gram panchayats where they've done good as a result of robust PBR, you know, downstream activities, then I would be, or my secretary would be more than happy to take it up aggressively, you know, and go to their offices and tell people that this is what you need to be doing. We would even look to mandate that. But then before that, we need some evidence to confront these people with. So that was another point. So I just got thinking, this wasn't a part of my original talk. In fact, sir, the chairman stole my thunder when he mentioned GPDPs before I'd even come in. So, but I was thinking that since you have all these well-meaning people out there in the forestry establishment, and these guys have been working, not all things are bad, not all the people involved are bad. So, and each state have got their own instruments. I speak from Himachal Pradesh's experience. They have something called participatory forest management regulations, which is a very good and a very sophisticated document, but it came in 2002 and it's not kept up. And I mean, you don't even need it anymore, but then you have this sovereign propensity, you know, of a state to hold on, ye to hamara act hai, this is ours, and so we'll go ahead and implemented to the exclusion of everything. So I just got thinking, listening to all the eminent speakers before this, that maybe if we have a statewide exit policy of all this multiplicity of societies, you know, in the same place, you would have a JFM committee and eco-development committee. There are so many village forest development societies, as you call them in Himachal Pradesh. If you're implementing a World Bank project, it becomes a village development committee. So the state has to devise and how you know, converge their roles and just have finally the constitutional mandated or the ones in the central acts, just these committees. And the Ministry of Environment Forest should be very clear in their communication, sir. So I am where people have been doing good and working nicely and really doing good to conserve the biodiversity and the ecosystems. So one wouldn't want these bodies to land very hard, which is why I say that if these could morph into BMCs or some such committees so that they have a continued role, I think it would make a lot of sense. And but such a strategy could only happen at the state level. Sitting out here, we can't take responsibility, or we can't, we don't have the right really to do it for the states without knowing about the local realities. Then there is this working plan. I've been listening about it since the time I was a probationer, and we would, you know, to begin with, have a chapter dedicated to how you're going to involve people in the working plan exercise. When we trained, I remember for a one day we had to be left to ourselves and to visit these villages, have against a questionnaire and bring it all back and somehow incorporate it. But it has largely been an afterthought. I was reading, this is an analogy, this is not directly related to what we are discussing here, but the analogy is that the white revolution, sir, this Operation Flood, you were producer centric. So you put the milk producer, the guy who's rearing these cows, at the center of it, and you had rich dividends. You've set a record for the whole world. When you were resource centric, as in the case of something like the Green Revolution, you have very modest growth rates to show for what you've been doing. So maybe this is what Vinay Tandon, sir, used to tell me, that we need to shift from putting resource at the center, a growing stock and, you know, annual sustainable yield. From that, we need to put the people at the center, and we need to do something like that. And I would be very happy to associate, sir, with anything that you would want me to do to further this agenda. and thank you very much. Back to you, Aparna ji.
Thank you, Mr. Nangar. A gentle reminder, if any of our participants, they have any question, please type your questions in the question and answer box. I now request Ms. Priya Tairi, Consultant Ministry of Tribal Affairs, to share her views on today's topic. Ms. Priya, please.
Thank you, Aparna. Am I audible? Thank you, Aparna. I would like to thank Tairi for inviting me on this forum today of the distinguished panelists. And it's a very interesting topic that we're discussing, something which is practically such a concern when it comes to the implementation of various executive arrangements or legal statutes, which are, I suppose, are very well intended. If we look in the framework that they have been made, I think they are well intended to ensure that the last mile participation is taking place and we are adequately capturing the requirements of communities, people on ground, and giving trying to build that decentralized participatory processes. Although the concern is very much valid that what has been missing is the means of communication, like how the community, how these many communities which are so concerned with each other are lacking to communicate or integrate or converge on the crucial aspects that they need to look into. When I start talking about the scheduled tribes and other traditional forest dwellers, recognition of forest right act, I'll start with the preamble of the act. It's an act to recognize and vest the forest rights and occupation in forest land and forest dwelling scheduled tribes and other traditional dwellers, which we call as people who are not STs, who are not registered in the schedule of the state, but who apparently have the same lifestyle and livelihood as STs of the state are, and they're residing in such forest for generations, but their rights on their ancestral lands could not be recorded. So this is the act provides for a framework for recording of such rights that needs to be vested within these communities. What is very crucial to note here is these rights of STs and OTFDs that are being provided under Forest Right Act also include the responsibility and authority for sustainable use, conservation of biodiversity, and maintenance of ecological balance, and thereby strengthening the conservation regime of the forest while ensuring livelihood and food security of the forest dwelling scheduled tribes and the traditional forest dwellers. I think this is a very important aspect wherein Forest Right Act essentially acknowledge or else recognize that these communities have been residing in such areas for generations, and they have been an integral part for the survival and sustainability of the forest ecosystem. So they do not distinguish essentially between these communities and forest as a resource in an independent manner. They put them together as one integral ecosystem. And as Mathur sir had begun very rightly when he was quoting Madhav Gadgeji, who always speak about integration of local communities' knowledge and understanding about the conservation of the resources, about accessing and utilizing these resources, not only for their livelihood, but for the very survival of the ecosystem that they have been living in. I would like to plug in here the National Forest Policy of 1988, which says that the holders of customary rights and concession in forest areas should be motivated to identify themselves with the protection and development of forest from which they have derived benefits. The rights and concession from forest should be primarily for the bona fide use of the community living within and around the forest area, especially tribals. Now, here, I think it's very important to put across that the kind of rights that are being provided under Forest Right Act, it provides a very comprehensive list of activities that are permissible, comprehensive list of rights that can be claimed and vested under Forest Right Act, ranging from right for self-cultivation purpose, right to inhabit in the forest lands, and the right for the access to minor forest produce. It's not only an access to minor forest produce, but it is access, collection, disposal of the minor forest produce. Then it also includes the right over adjacent catchments, catchment area. It provides right over adjacent water bodies for fishing or other purposes. It provides right for the pastoralist communities and nomadic communities. It also provides right for the traditional seasonal resource access. It provides such entitlement. It has a specific right for the primitively tribal groups, as it identified that a tribal would not identify its home only as a dwelling unit, but as a habitation as a whole. So it talks of a right which goes beyond only residing and accessing forest for the livelihood purposes, but it is more of an integral cultural aspect that is important. And a number of right that goes beyond, including the right to protect, regenerate, or conserve or manage any community forest resource which they have been traditionally protecting and conserving for sustainable use. I think these are very important components of the Act that brings in that the Act not only allows the forest dwelling communities to access such resources that they have been accessing traditionally, but it also ensures and entrusts them with the right to, it is both the way, in fact, it's the right and the duty also under Section 5 of the Act to conserve such resources. And it goes beyond only about resources related to MFP. It also goes, if you look at the details of Section 5 of the Act, it goes protection of wildlife, forest, biodiversity. That is something that goes beyond the ambit of access for a forest right holder. It also provides the duty for ensuring that the adjoining catchment areas, water resources, and other ecological sensitive areas are adequately protected. It also provides the duty to the right holder for the protection of the habitat of forest right holders for the scheduled tribes and scheduled other traditional forest dwellers. And it also asks them to ensure that the decision taken in Gram Sabha, which is the on which the forest rights are, the community forest rights are interested upon, they are supposed to be regulated in a manner that any access to community forest resource should not lead to the depletion of the forest, and any activity which adversely affect the wildlife, forest, and biodiversity are complied with. So the statute that puts in place the Rule 420 Committee, what we call as, which is a committee that needs to be formed by the right holders to ensure that all the duties provided under Section 5 of the Act are complied with, are taken care of, and then the conservation management plan is prepared in a manner that it can also be accommodated in the working plan of the Forest Department. So it provides a spectrum of duties, it's provided a spectrum of rights. At the same time, it also provides a spectrum of duties that needs to be taken care of by the forest dwellers, which I would say has not been the same for a very long time. But if we come back to the National Forest Policy of 88, which puts the trust that the customary right holder should be motivated to identify themselves with the protection and development of the forest from which they derive the benefits, I think it is pretty much in sync with it. It is another statute that is just allowing and an enabling framework to execute the spirit that was carried in the National Forest Policy of 1988. Moving forward, when we see, so apparently the National Forest Policy of 1988 provided us with the FMC structure, which and there has been this discussion all the time, which Dr. Sharma also captured, that, you know, which the statutory committees and non-statutory committee and which hold a larger say. I think we can actually see this to be an statutory extension to what was an administrative arrangement that was created before. What really needs to recognize here essentially is there's a paradigm shift in terms of the kind of planning processes that was built when James FMC was coming in picture. That has been changed a lot when the process such as Rule 420 Committee, which we call as the CFR Committee, the Community Forest Resource Management Committee, that has been envisaged under Forest Right Act. So I think, yes, that is one of the biggest changes that we have been anticipating. But I think that is how actively we want to engage into and empowering Gram Sabhas and the communities to ensure that they have been participating in the planning and protection process, the conservation process, the way a preamble of Forest Right Act would be putting it across. When we discuss several other committees that exist on the on field, as Yogesh ji has put up in his presentations, and yes, there is a lot of I would say overlap of responsibilities in a way that needs to be followed by the Forest Right committees, and that would be entrusted with various other committees. For instance, JFMC, which is more on terms of conservation, but similarly for biodiversity. For instance, in biodiversity committee, you would want to record the traditional knowledge under Section 31K of FRA. It provides the right to access to biodiversity and community right to intellectual property and traditional knowledge related to biodiversity and cultural diversity. So I think this is a very important component that when the implementation of Section 31K of FRA takes place, it automatically boosts up the implementation of or recording of the public biodiversity register that is anticipated under BMC. So although they are very overlapping in nature, they are equally complementary in nature. And I think that is something very essential when we are coming out with any framework that should lead to the interaction between the communities, or let me say the convergence between the communities. For instance, FRA, the rule framed under FRA has this rule 16, which discuss the post-claim support and handholding to the forest right forest right holders. As Alok Premji said it, that you know, essentially under GPDP, the Gram Panchayat would be more interested in undertaking the development work. That is what 16 of FRA also discussed. It of course engages the respective department to bring it together. So it basically recommends the convergence of all possible developmental facilities that is there on ground to ensure that the economical and economical, social, and political development of the right holder is ensured, so that he is empowered, capacitated in a manner to function in the capacities that are requisite for implementation of the duties that are entrusted in a right holder. And this is an overarching framework that is provided, but I think it is equally important to ensure that we do have such frameworks, which is very essential to building a convergence or a forum for interaction that is already accommodated in the Act at one or the other place. So I think it is more of a concern about how we come up, bring in the requisite positions which are already there in the Act, and we based on those we try to build up another forum wherein we can create an interactive model. So that's one. One of the other question which came within the presentation of Yogesh ji was, how do you define the customary boundaries? That is one of the questions that even we struggle when we discuss the CFR CFR committees, that how do you define the territorial jurisdiction of a Gram Sabha, for instance, over which it has to build its conservation and management plan. And as it is rightly said, it is not adequate to only look at the panchayat boundaries or the village boundaries, because they majorly include the abadi areas and more of common spaces that would be there within the panchayat or village. But it may not essentially include the forest area or adjacent areas where the traditional access would be where would be the traditional corridors would be there, or where the traditional forest resource would be lied, which would be accessed over generations. So I think this is one area which needs to build up together. I think it needs a consensus when we discuss, as much as the boundary of the villages, we should have a consensus discuss when we say what is the traditional area of access, be it under BMC, be it under CFRC or any other committees. There has to be some consensus in terms of how that traditional access is being recorded, identified, and those boundaries are being developed, so that we also ensure that there are adequate jurisdiction which is being marked and there are no conflict on ground. Because many a time it's seen that when we develop any guideline here, situations on ground would vary either from state to state or based on how the resources are developed or the natural boundaries are unfolding on ground. So I think these are the area that really need to be taken into account when we discuss any integration. About JFMC, there has been one of the concerns which we have been discussing since a very long time. When the CFRC comes in place, a lot of responsibilities that are entrusted, as I discussed earlier also, under JFMCs are also part of the responsibilities that are entrusted with CFRC, CFRMC, and how do we integrate with it. So Minister of Tribal Affairs had provided these advisories earlier also, that the community forest resources needs to be provided or vested under the Gram Sabhas only and not with any other committee per se. And it is further the role of the Gram Sabha to identify the to create a rule for any committee among its members and enters the responsibility that are provided under Section 5 of the Act, and then ensure that they are preparing their conservation and management plan and they're executing their conservation and management plan as directed by the Gram Sabhas. But then surely it was Ministry of Tribal Affairs has made it clear time and again that it should not be interested in within any other committee, but it should be more with the Gram Sabha. So when we take into account any kind of integration, that's one of the very key changes that would need to take place either at the administrative level or at the statutory level, that how we ensure the integration between the two. Although it has also very clearly said that if there has been JFMCs functional in the area and there are also CFRMCs, it is encouraged that members of JFMCs can either be co-opted or they play an advisory role to the CFRMCs, so that CFRMCs capacities can be built and the mandated conservation and management plan that needs to be developed by CFMCs can be developed in a better way. So this has been the stake of the ministry. This was specifically in concern of JFMC, but this has been the case with BMC also, because Ministry of Tribal Affairs do recognize that the traditional knowledge would even the forest right holders would be the bearer of traditional knowledge, or under at least Section 31K, they do have the right to preserve and claim their traditional knowledge regarding access to biodiversity. And if it is a concern of, say, even sharing of benefits, they would be one of the major contributors in those domains. So these are some of the areas that needs to be looked into and taken into account when we talk about effectivizing and diversifying any developing any communication forum for all these communities on ground. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Thaili. I now request Dr. Charan Singh, scientist at FFRI Dehradun, to share his views.
Hello. Hello, am I audible?
Yes,
hello.
Sir, you're audible.
Yes, hello, good evening everybody. So before speaking something, I will introduce myself and my organization. The ICFRI, International Forestry Research and Education, working in on India level worldwide. In India we have 9 institutes with 4 research centers. And we are covering the all three aspects: research, extension, and education. And I was going through the MOU signed between TERI and FRI and ICFRI. So I have noted down some points here that we have collaborative areas to work together in areas of forestry and land environment research, land degradation, forest biodiversity, forest biotechnology, forest economics, resource mapping, climate change policy research, and capacity building programs. And I will talk about the networking. That's the essential aspect where BMCs are working, JFMCs are working, but there is a need of networking. and their association, active association with the institutions, organizations. So we have a need to work in an integrated approach. So to cover the all three aspects, research, extension, education. So they should be linked together and associated with organization in a pyramid way. So there is need of common minimum program and integrated project to covering all aspects for biodiversity conservation by concept that where to grow biodiversity and from where to use biodiversity resources and where to conserve it. We have to identify the areas for biodiversity propagation, for biodiversity conservation, for the use of biodiversity. I am dealing with agroforestry today. So I would talk about agroforestry also. There is rotational forestry. Farmer is conserving agroforestry in a direct way on rotation basis. So there should be involvement of farmers and weaker sections also, because they are near to nature. They are more near to nature to conserve the biodiversity. So there should be the involvement in program planning on biodiversity conservation, and interlinking is required among these BMCs, FMCs, and institutions. And there is an involvement of local people. There is a need of participant local people in a program planning from conceptualization to completion of the project or a program. So there are some needs for integration. So ICFRI and TERI can work together on these aspects. And after conceptualization and even completion of a program, follow-up is required in any field. Where is biodiversity conservation or other field? So there is a follow-up is required. And after follow-up, if there some drawbacks are found, then we have to rectify it. And if there are some drawbacks, we have to draw program again and work on it. And local manpower is required. We require local manpower with vernacular language so that they can work in situ in that area to propagate the biodiversity and conserve it. So there is a need of local manpower, local village workers, and women empowerment can be done by participation of women more and more. So I have noted the points, and these are my suggestions. I am not coming with the slides because I got information late from my headquarters, but I have their MOU signed. So I highlighted some area of work which can carry and ICFRI can do. So these are my suggestions. So thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. We will now begin the question and answer session. I can see there are already a few questions, but due to the paucity of time, we may not be able to take all the questions. But I'll try that the panelists will try and address as many as they can. So the first question is, Mr. Resham Mungikar wants to know that what is the operation period of Gram Panchayat Development Plan? So any of our panelists can answer this question.
Thank you. Gram Panchayat. So it started with there used to be a program called Backward Region Grant Fund, BRGF, which I think it came to an end in 2014 or 15. But before that, a lot of funds used to go to the Gram Panchayat and under the BRGF. And at that time, as with any plan, it was mandated that you need to have for 4-5 year period. So there the 5 year period was mandated that in respect of your funds, you need to plan for 5 years, because a plan typically has to be over a period of time. But it has also been seen that most plans remain unfulfilled because the promise of revenues sometimes is not kept. And so it is a plan mainly on paper. So when the GPDP thing got started in 2018, the ministry felt, in consultation with the state also felt that let us have a perspective plan in the background. But for the purpose of this planning exercise, we are just going to plan for a year. So the GPDPs that are being spoken about right now, they are only for a year. So if people are planning their activities now, they are planning for the year 21-22, and the activities that are planned would start and come to an end within this financial year, the coming financial year. So that is the operation of the plan. And as for the campaign, if that is a part of the question, then the campaign typically lasts from the month of October to December. And this year we've extended this because of COVID situations and all that. So I hope that answers this question. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The next question is, as already said in the Biodiversity Act, the cognizance of BMC is mandatory in all the decisions related to the development work in that region. However, that is not taking place. What are the measures available for local communities for the same?
See, this is a little tricky question. Why I say tricky is like this, that there are certain provisions which are made under the law and there are some ground realities. And if you heard me speaking a little while back, when I said that it is only recently that we have been able to establish the biodiversity management committees, and these are, I am being very candid in saying, right now on paper, we are still struggling to make them effective. Okay, so once we are able to make them effective, or as we go along and make them effective, as they develop better and better PBRs, then we will be in a much better position to regulate anything. And I would also say, I mentioned earlier in my intervention, that we are now looking at the access and benefit sharing mechanism, which exists on paper in terms of law, but in reality, the conserver of the resource is not getting benefited. So we want that once the BMC will get activated, once the registers will get formulated, once we have the description of the resource, then we can think in terms of how revenue generation, how benefits can be shared by the local community. See, that will be the real test of all our working. And once the finances start coming to people, then they realize the benefit of their working, of their organization. So it will take a little while, but definitely it is on the card, and that is what we are working for. So give us a little time. We will be looking into these mechanisms and ensuring that what is prescribed in the law is actually followed, neither more nor less. Thank you.
Aparna, I'm taking liberty to take guidance and also suggestion from Dr. Mathur and Alok. I think BMCs are at Gram Panchayat level. Community Forest Resource Management Committees are Gram Sabha level. JFMCs are also there. EDCs are also there. My suggestion is that Gram Panchayat sanctity has to be maintained. And it is the responsibility of Gram Sabha to take care of the biological diversity management committees at the how many villages are under that particular Gram Panchayat every level. As far as CFMC level, it is already with the Gram Sabha level. So there is no need to change anything. As far as EDC and JFMC, Priya has rightly mentioned that if a product village is Gram Sabha is a particular village is near the protected area, then EDC has been co-opted by the Gram Sabha. If normal forest JFMCs are there in the vicinity of that particular Gram Sabha, so the JFMC member must be co-opted by the Gram Sabha. And when PESA is there, FRA is there, even BDA is also recognized the important, even constitution have the everything has been derived from the 73rd amendment and many laws and many institutions. So that at present, we cannot ignore Gram Panchayat and the Gram Sabha. So that at least what we are going to, what I am thinking, or what is the thinking of Terry while doing this research, and that Gram Panchayat sanctity has to be maintained, and within Gram Panchayat, Gram Sabha sanctity, because things are varied from state to state, should 5, should 6, basically decentralized community-based natural resource management, maybe in form of BMC, in form of, so we want to have that kind of a thinking in our mind on these two points. We really request Dr. Mathur to give his suggestions or advice, or Alok to give a suggestion or advice, whether we can suggest that kind of a mechanism and linkages amongst the different institution for the common and overlapping mandate.
Alok, come in, please.
So thank you, sir. You're right, we need to build some mechanism. I think that right now we could only make some tentative suggestions, and we need to talk about these issues more. And like I said, that the reality is different from one state to the other, sir. In some places, people really swear by their JFM committees, and these people have done outstanding work. And in another other kind of places, these have just become like contractors, and they just carry out work and then they scoot. So in view of this biodiversity of committees, one would imagine that this needs careful consideration, and we need to be engaging with the states. I'll say that more and more, because this campaign that we run, we find, sir, that wherever we start taking a unilateral decision, it doesn't get very far in implementation, because the state needs to own this. And I'm sure this is something, because the argument is pretty solid. Nobody can shirk from it, that Panchayat is the main body that is responsible for these activities. In fact, sir, under the Panchayat Raj Act, there are also these subject committees. So just as at the macro level, we have the parliamentary committee. So under Panchayat also, in a state like West Bengal, they have 23 different committees looking after groups of subjects. And in some places, they've organized themselves very well. At the other end of the spectrum, we have some place like Himachal Pradesh, where they just have an administrative committee and the finance committee. So it has also been our endeavor that these committees and all should be increasingly encouraged, because when one speaks about the Gram Panchayat, so you just reach out to the sarpanch, the main, the village headman, and that is not fair on the others who've also fought and won in an election and who are elected representatives. So the thing was that if you could train each of these elected representatives in a certain subject area, you know, turn them into some kinds of para experts through layered inputs given to them through various training programs, through visits and all that, then these people could continue to endow the panchayat even after their term expires. So this person now, if I compare it with the present context, so I'm talking about the BMC person, who's going to be the mainstay of all biodiversity related activities. So when you speak to the Gram Panchayat, and if you are a forestry biodiversity person, then you need to reach out to this person and who would be guiding this. So so on the one hand, the departments who think that they are, you know, the people who've been charged with the responsibility to the exclusion of everything else, once these people from various departments are on board, then we need to involve these committees more and more until it becomes a habit, until it becomes an accepted practice. So, but I didn't think that answers the question completely. I will just reiterate myself that we need to start a process. So there needs to be a state specific thing where for each state you note down, जैसे कि वर्ल्ड बैंक प्रोजेक्ट्स होते हैं सर, सो वी हैव हैड अ वाटरशेड डेवलपमेंट प्रोजेक्ट व्हेन आई फर्स्ट जॉइंड इन 1999 और समथिंग, आई सस्पेक्ट सम ऑफ दोस कमिटीज वुड स्टिल बी अराउंड, वेयर देयर ओनली फंक्शन टू बिगिन विद वाज टू हेल्प द डिपार्टमेंट आउट विद द एग्जीक्यूशन ऑफ द प्रोजेक्ट एक्टिविटीज एंड टू कलेक्ट द बेनिफिशियरी शेयर दैट वाज गिवन. सो यू वुड हैव अ लॉट ऑफ दीज कमिटीज एंड आउट ऑफ द 10% कमिटीज दैट रिमेन, I also suspect that there would be two and three who've done outstanding work, and maybe they are the, you know, the rightful heirs or the rightful people to don the mantle of biodiversity conservation or any kind of such activity that we are looking at. So back to you, sir. I don't know if I addressed that concern very well.
I have two quick comments. Two quick comments. One is that Maharashtra state has amended this Panchayati Raj Act, and they have made the BMCs as subcommittee of Gram Sabha. I think it will be useful to understand their experience and how they have been able to, one is do amendment, and second is implementation of that provision, how it has been successful. That is one thing. Second thing, we often forget we are such a huge country, and we really forget the numbers, the way we need to work on. And we have 118,000 JFM committees, which are many of them might be on paper, but even if we consider if 10% itself are active, it means we are directly accessing not less than 11,000-12,000 villages at one go, which is a huge potential that we need to tap upon. So we really need to have a kind of assessment, which are these, how many number of these committees are really active and really can be co-opted as a part of this process. Otherwise, we would end up in killing the existing mechanism in the process of forming another mechanism. So that is that kind of validation process is required at somewhere where we can form synergy and not kill the process.
Thank you, Yogesh. JV, I have a question. What is the duration of your current project with Terry?
Duration is ending in the April, but this is a very short term, and definitely we are going to suggest ICFRE. Of course, ICFRE is doing on behalf of the Ministry of Environment for this research study. So out of the wisdom of all today, I have listened in the last, Yogesh has mentioned, and we also saying we have submitted one document to the Ministry of Tribal Affairs as the community forest resource right and governance model. So we have to respect each and every institution which is in existence right now, how to make use of those institutions, experience of those institutions, and Gram Panchayat is there, as Yogesh mentioned, where the BMCs are at the Gram Sabha level. Definitely, it is good idea to have Gram Sabha level. No, I do not know whether Act permit or not, but we can give the suggestion. Gram Sabha level, Community Forest Resource Management Committee, that is under the FRA, but this committee has to respect if JFMC is in existence in the overlapping jurisdiction or the EDC in existence. So that one way, the supremacy of the Gram Sabha would be maintained, and also they will be making use of the capacity of the Joint Forest Management Committee and the Eco Development Committees. So that we are thinking in this direction. So we need your guidance and advice, Vinod. Please, if there is a some conflict or some overlap mandate or is not to function, cannot function at the ground level. So that we request you what you think about this mechanism, Vinod.
I have a broader comments first. See, a country as big as India, you cannot have one single model for
one single model. Yes.
It will never work. However wish we may try, it will not work. So now we should see, and that is what I was asking you, that what is the duration of your project? So that do you have chance to look at a few models? We pick up the northeastern one, we look at central Indian one and try to see that which is delivering better result. And the point I want to make here is that we have to define what will be the unit of convergence.
Yes.
And that is why, Alok, I said that GPTP to me appears to be a mechanism which is very well recognized, which is has a legal sanctity, and within that everybody then pitches in. So that is one point. And the other point which I want to make is that all of us need to move towards digital India. See, what I'm doing at my little level, I can tell you, I mentioned that there are 2,75,000 BMCs which have been constituted.
Mm-hmm.
You ask me, Dr. Mathur, is there a list of 2,75,000? I cannot produce you the list. So what is my mandate? I am now for the last 4 months struggling to prepare a dashboard which provides minimalistic information that this is the state, this is the region, this is the district, this is the Gram Sabha, and these are the string of BMCs which are associated with that. And wherever these have been, there are people in it, we need to have their names, we need to have their contact numbers. See, the beauty about this Gram Panchayat database is that you open it up, you will find these details over there. So what we are trying to do as a first level of convergence, we want to bring this thing together that our dashboard matches with the Ministry of Panchayat Raj dashboard. And then we have the NIC, which is having a complete database at the village level. So a lot of information which are to flow in my PBRs are actually available, but we are not able to access to them. So maybe it is not part of your project, but I have my eyes set that this is the way in which convergence will happen. At least in a district, we should be able to say, in your presentation, JV, and in Yogesh, you mentioned that there are 10, 12 different committees. Now, okay, fine. Let these be committee, but somewhere we should have, this is the mandate, this is the membership, this is the frequency, which committee meets, which committee doesn't meet, where we can mix them up, where we keep them separate. So see, this kind of a very simple thing, I wish we would have done it 10 years back, but doesn't matter if we have not done it 10 years back, why not? Why don't we do it today?
Why not?
That is what I'm trying to say, that these simple dashboards can make a lot of difference in our organization, in our reducing of overlap and building synergies. So my request to you would be that we should, as a recommendation of this webinar that we have done, we should endorse the kind of work that you are doing. We should say that there is a need for digital convergence. If we don't have a physical convergence, let's have a digital convergence. And we can pick up certain states and we can pick up certain districts where we can demonstrate that this kind of convergence can work. I will stop here, but wait for Alok and your reaction to that.
Vinod, one thing I'd like to mention over here, because we have prepared a forest governance model for each state under a project given Ministry of Tribal Affairs. So that because we have not repeated the same kind of work with ICFRE, so because last year we have conducted that research, full 1 year we took, and we have more than 25 focus group sessions in different states, state with all stakeholders. So we have in our hand the forest governance model for each state. Definitely we will make use of that data, yeah, that information we already with us, we have done it, and we can provide even to ICWARI the state-wise recommendations in which state what to do and which says what to do, so that we can because I have not mentioned earlier this particular aspect, that information is with us and will make use while giving some of the recommendations to the ICFRE, means to the government of India. So please,
So I'm glad you mentioned about the need to have interoperability of data, sir. There is an application of our ministry called the Local Government Directory, LGD directory, which is like an Aadhaar card, sir, of revenue entities. It is the Registrar General Office. They have their enumeration blocks. So we've devised it so that there has to be a whole number of enumeration blocks inside a revenue village. And I would request everybody to make use of that. In fact, I can put you in touch with the LGD team with us. So that is like another line in your address, sir. You have another column against your village where you write this LGD code. And having done that, then it is possible for you to even Ministry of Tribal Affairs, if you seed your data and the schemes and all that you are sanctioning, the projects that you are sanctioning to various states, if you seed that, then it will be possible for you to know that in a Gram Panchayat, there are three layers of, there is the development block thing. So there is village, Gram Panchayat, development block and so on. Then it also has village and tehsil and subdivision. And then it also has a third layer, which is the legislative assembly and all that. So that can serve as an important instrument. Or, sir, back to you.
Aparna, you carry on with your proceedings.
Yes. Okay, sir. So shall we go for one more question or directly to the concluding remarks?
No, if you have question, you can ask question.
Yeah, there is one more question. So the question is, for the communities who have forest rights, who are exiting the resources, how the sustainable use is going to be measured? Is there any cap or measuring tools for the decision on that?
Aparna, I will give this reply. Hena. Okay. There is no such tool is available for maintaining sustainability of the resource. Largely, I am talking of the non-timber forest produce and minor forest produce. Of course, for harvesting, techniques are there. It won't be possible to quantify the quantum of the minor forest produce to be taken out from the forest. How much to be taken out from respective tree, how much the underground roots, how much is the bushes, how much is the bushes, so that in most of the working plants, in most of the minor forest produce, different state government, they have produced the tools, technique for harvesting, sustainable harvest techniques. If we are able to implement sustainable harvest technique for harvesting the respective produce from the forest, or by default and automatically, the sustainability could be maintained. And we have worked for the Ministry of Tribal Affairs at TriFed for the more than 3 years on this particular aspect, and quantification is not, if at all, we have quantified, suppose, and somebody has taken out more material from one tree and that tree will be damaged, so that local people, villagers, they know how to take out sustainably. Of course, due to their different financial interest and their different other mechanisms, Ayurvedic firms and factories or their agents are misleading the, they are giving contact to one person and who is dabang in the that village and go and harvest maximum produce unsustainably. So when the authority will be with Gram Sabha, so the people will decide that who will harvest what. If medicinal plant, local veg will harvest, they know the techniques. That is why PBRs, and having a documentation of the local knowledge of the Veds and other minor forest products collectors, or so that that will resolve the problem of the sustainability or the sustainable harvest from the, of the resource from the natural resources area, maybe forest, maybe wildlife, whatever it is. And again, one thing I like to mention over here, Wildlife Protection Act, there are PAs, and there are many other minor forest products could be harvested sustainably. But in Wildlife Protection Act, if harvested for the improving the habitat, that is, can be decided by the chief wildlife. But as a forester, largely I am saying, as a forester, we are not progressive. We are more conservative, because the name is conservative. That is a more conservative. This is not a good idea to have that kind of a scientific management. We should have the scientific management even in the PAs. We should take out how much we can take out without disturbing the habitat, without disturbing the composition of the crop, composition of the tree species, bushes over there. So that we have to think as a forester beyond the conservative limit of the protection and conservation. One day we will lose many of the species, and we are losing. And again, in the I would like to mention, Ministry of Tribal Affairs has assigned 74 species for the Minimum Support Price. You will be surprised to know 24 are not available for the commercial harvest in the forest. Even states know, states have issued notifications to ban the but issuing notification is not the solution. Implementing those notification into the field by the forest guard, forester, and so that who can do? As a forester, we have failed. As a government agency, we have failed. One agency we are before us is a Gram Sabha, community based forest governance mechanism is there. Let's try that. Maybe possible that will also fail, but let's without trying them, how can we say that they will get failed or they will be successful in that? I hope the kind of legislative force and empowerment have been given by different laws and legislations to the people. It should be implemented under the umbrella of either Gram Panchayat or the Gram Sabha. That I want to say this, we are going to with the consent of with a concluding remark of the chair, this is our view. I'm expressing our view of the Terry, but whatever the finally concluded by the chair, so that we will have
I would like to comment here something.
Yeah,
I would like to make a comment here that it is important to note that the Forest Right Act provides a larger emphasis on the traditional knowledge of sustainably using the forest resources. So the forest resources that has been allowed, that has been granted the access under the Forest Right Act, essentially carries this word for access for the sustainable use, and access for the sustainable use that has been undertaken traditionally. So it has been providing larger emphasis on the fact that the communities has been residing within the same vicinity. They has been accessing these resources for a very long time, and they know that how to harvest this this systematically. There is, of course, it can be seen in bits and pieces that at certain point in time, certain MFPs have been conserved in a very well structured manner, while certain others are not. And that is essentially where the role of Section 5 of FRA comes in place, wherein it empowers the Gram Sabha to undertake and entrust the duties and responsibility for the sustainable harvesting of MFPs. So there's something called as Rule 4-1 Committee, which is proposed under the forest rules to undertake the responsibilities provided under Section 5 of the Act. And their responsibility is to prepare the plan, conservation and management plan, to ensure that all the accesses that are granted under the Forest Right Act are implemented in place, and communities and people do have, you know, can exercise their right to go and access and undertake or harvest the MFP and resources that they are willing to harvest for their self-consumption or livelihood. but at the same time they are doing it sustainably. So section 5 of the act has a specific clause which says that ensure that the decision taken in the Gram Sabha to regulate the access to community forest resources and stop any activity that adversely affect the wildlife animal wild animals, forest and biodiversity are complied with. So essentially it means that whatever conservation and management plan that Rule 41 committee, which is the CFRCM committee, it's supposed to formulate, should take it into account that the existing rights of the forest right holders and how far they can go to access their right, and there will be adequate checks put on place so that they do not harvest anything unsustainably. That is the essential premise of the act, and we are really hopeful with the CFRC guidelines coming in place, the committee would be operationalized very soon and we can incorporate the habit of sustainably harvesting and accessing their rights within the forest right community.
One thing I'd like to suggest, Priya, to you in particularly, I have seen the committee's report. I have given my comments also, so that what would be the shape final, that is a future thing. One thing you can do, mentioning in the Forest Right Act that sustainable harvest and sustainable harvest sustainability has also been defined as defined in Section 2 of the Biological Diversity Act 2002. What is Section 2 of Biological Diversity Act? Harvest in such manner and such way that resource could be available. This is a theory. This is theoretical. What I am talking to you, That is a practical aspect. Most of the working plans, most of the forest department, in fragmented way, they have a sustainable harvest technique for most of the minor forest produce species. You take out those documents, compile it at the Ministry of Forest, being nodal ministry, and build capacity of the Gram Sabha committees so that. I'm not saying that they do not know the sustainable techniques. So maybe they must be knowing for few species. They may not be knowing for other species. So here the larger job of the Ministry of Forest, being nodal Ministry of Forest Right Act, that available knowledge with the respective forest department, because we know that we have collected all the information while doing MFP minimum support price. Focus group discussion and household survey, we collected that. We have seen that a lot more knowledge is available in the country with different states, but this is lying in the almirahs, lying in the drawers, and we are not collecting, we are not making use of that knowledge. So that I am talking to you that implementation aspect is a practical aspect of that. So sorry, I have taken a bit time. So now Aparna, you carry on.
Two quick suggestions.
Yeah.
Two quick points. One point is that sustainable harvesting techniques, yes, it is important to implement and build capacities on that. And another tool, that is the People's Biodiversity Register, is not a one-time document. It is supposed to be updated. So it's a kind of database. So that is an important source to understand what is getting available in the field over a period of time. So it's a monitoring mechanism through which one understands whether sustainable harvesting techniques are really useful or not. And I think the combination of these things would yield us results in terms of sustainable harvesting of minor forest products.
Thank you, sir. I want to thank all the panelists for addressing the queries of our participants. Now I request Dr. Mathur to give the concluding remarks. So please.
Thank you, Aparna. I think we had a very interesting discussion in the last 1.5 to 2 hours. If you look at the composition of this panel, it has the three ministries represented: the Ministry of Panchayati Raj, the Environment and Forest, and Tribal Affairs. And I think here we are not part of this discussion to fight turf wars and who is superior. See, I'm very clear that when we are talking of democratic governance at the grassroots level, definitely the Ministry of Panchayati Raj has a larger stake in that. Ministry of Environment, Forest has hajar other things to do. And of course, Ministry of Tribal Affairs, because they work for the tribal, they will have to operate wherever the tribal communities are existing. The point I'm making is that we need to look at convergence. We need to look at existing mechanisms. And as we know that Alok talked about not only the Gram Panchayat development plan, he also talked about the local government directories which are there. And I am pushing forward the ideas of Digital India, where whatever these committees are, whatever their roles are, these are very well defined so that we can bring in convergence on that. But I pick up one point from what Yogesh said, which is very important, which is about the jurisdiction of these bodies. And believe me when I say that, not that they are sorted out in terrestrial systems, they are a nightmare in marine systems. I am now sitting in Chennai, and I now want to know, there are 10 coastal states. Where are my marine PBR boundary? And believe me, nobody was able to tell me that, how do I define? At least in terrestrial system, you know where that panchayat is, where that boundary is, there can be less or more or whatever. But are we not supposed to look at the coastal and marine? And therefore, Alok, I have constituted a committee which has the chief naval hydrographer of India, because they are the people who decide and tell us that what is our foray into the sea, how many nautical miles can we go. And that area is important because all the coastal and marine resources are there. All our fisher folks are going over there. When we talk of benefit sharing, when we talk of access, when we talk of resources, who is going to define where these resources are and whose jurisdiction is? So the point I'm making is that, Yogesh, yes, defining the jurisdiction is important, and we will try to do it as we go along. And the other point which came up from Alok is to look at, can we, while we're looking at convergence, can we also look at what he called, I think, an exit policy, what has served its purpose, but what needs to be now not pushed forward without acting on anybody's turf war. See, creating these committees itself was a big thing which has happened in the past. But now we know that in the view of convergence, which one is going to be more effective, and how the purpose of MOTA or of BMC can be served by piggyback riding on the Panchayati Raj system. And JV, as you said, for me too, Gram Panchayat and Gram Sabhas are the bodies which we need to look into, because they have a constitutional function and a constitutional responsibility, and they are far more funded than anything else over there. My colleagues also said that, no sir, why don't you push BMC, BMC, BMC? Are Baba, what to push BMC when it is not able to stand on its leg? So we definitely now need to do some piggyback riding. We want to make our registers effective, and only when we are able to demonstrate a working model of access and benefit sharing, where a local person is able to get some benefit out of it, then he will realize, or she will realize, that MOTA is doing this, and BMC is doing this, and MOPR is doing this. So we don't need to take any decision today, but we need to continue with this dialogue. And for JV, you need to pick up certain states and certain districts where you can demonstrate that this is what we were. These were the 7, 8, 9 committees. This is where they overlap, and this is where they come in conflict. And when they come in conflict, then we need to go back and see the law, that what is the law position over there. So we are on the right track. I wish this discussion was taking place 5 years back, 10 years back, 15 years back. That it has not taken place, that means it was waiting for Alok, JV and myself to come, and Priya to come in here. But let's go with an open mind. Let us start working on that. And if we can demonstrate as a part of your report, these recommendations will be very, very useful. So I don't want to sound something to be concluding with drastic results, but in my own humble way, I would say that we need to talk to each other, and we need to understand our positions and try to work better for the person who is at the cutting edge of the resource governance. So back to you.
Thank you so much, sir. All these valuable and positive insights gave us a new perspective that should be adopted while implementing this work. As I mentioned earlier, we'll be having a series of webinars and we will be sending you the invites for the same. And we look forward
to. So you want to close it now, or is there any?
Sir, we are just closing it. So I'd just like to thank all the panelists and the participants for sparing time and joining us for today's webinar. Thank you very much.